My name is Alec Leckie. I'm a researcher in the Intel Labs organization of Intel. Our lab is mainly, well, it's data center focused. The data center is such a beast that the element we're looking at is more orchestration. So orchestration is how you take your service and how you place it on the infrastructure. So while we've been a regular contributor to FP7 and H2020 and a lot of the European funded research projects, while initially it might have been more just for the funding to spin up the lab, now it's mainly more to do with a lot of the use cases. So one of the great things that the H2020 projects do is they bring in partners with real world use cases. So BT, a telco in particular, is looking at how it's going to deploy some of its NFEs, so or its VNFs, its network functions. So we're looking at going in and using some of our background research to try and resolve elements of that. And that's what kind of we bring to the recap table. So I'll step through some of it. Kind of focus maybe on what we're trying to accomplish with the BT use case, and then if any questions, you can let me know. That's kind of like a standard intro slide. It's probably no different to what Gary would have gone through earlier on. And while the original report is a couple of years old now at this stage, the numbers haven't really changed in that you've got Moore's Law on the left, so your compute is reducing every 2 years. So there is savings there, but what's happening is the data volume is doubling roughly about every 18 months, which means you need more capacity to store it all. The apps themselves are becoming more complex, and about every 2 years you get a doubling in that as well. And similarly, your operational costs, your OPEX is increasing. Again, it's doubling, they reckon around every 8 years as well. And lastly, of course, the ability to manage all that. So within our lab, what we've been trying to do is we've been kind of looking for opportunities of where we can drive down the total cost of ownership and improve performance. Because one of the main issues with the infrastructure providers in supporting service level agreements is they're just over-provisioning because they don't really know how the app is going to perform. So they'll throw four cores at it when maybe only two is required. And that's two cores that you potentially could go and sell to a different customer. So there is money to be made if we can identify how an application performs on the hardware it's running on, with a view to assigning just the relevant infrastructure to support that, and yet provide more infrastructure that you can go and then sell on to other customers. that essentially is almost the poster child to why NFE adoption is slow, because the telecom equipment manufacturers will certify their application on that dedicated hardware to within five nines. Now, if you take that function, write it in a bit of Java, put it in a VM, and then run it on a standard server, you're going to see massive swings in how that service performs. And you can see it here. So T-Nova was an FP7 funded research project from last year. And we took a standard network function, just a network traffic analyzer, which basically just, as you run network traffic through it, we just categorized it and we wrote it to a log file, trivial type stuff. But the point is, if you run that with a standard amount of RAM associated with it and a standard number of virtual cores assigned to it, we were seeing numbers around the 500 bytes that were being categorized in a per second basis. Now, you take that exact same VM and you don't change a single thing about it, but you attach it to cores that are connected to an SRIOV, which is a direct channel from the core to a PCI Express network card. So it's a direct channel. You can see a 10x improvement on the amount of traffic that's been processed in that per second basis. And that swing is so much that the telcos can't go near it. And that's what is essentially delaying it. So until we can certify VNFs on standard off-the-shelf hardware to within a five nines, it's going to be a slow process. And even still, you can see as we ramped up the network traffic, we're not even at line rate. So there's still quite a lot of work to be done, and this is the kind of areas we're looking at within the lab. So to start off with, what we're trying to do is we're trying to understand the landscape, the infrastructure itself that all these services are running on. And what we've done is we've created an open source product that you'll find on GitHub, and there's links later on. We call it The Landscaper. And what it does is it takes a cloud environment, which is the services that are currently executing, the VMs and the virtualized infrastructure, whether that's, as I say, a VM or whether it's a container, and then essentially the physical attributes that you have gone and assigned to it. And we've kind of split it up into three different layers. And then what we'll try and do is we'll try and enrich those layers by adding telemetry later on. And essentially, that's what you kind of get. At the very, very top, you'll have the list of services. In the middle layer, the virtual, what you'll have is you'll have the VMs, you'll have the VNICs, the network cards, the virtual network cards, you'll have the vSwitches. And each of them will be assigned resources. So what we've tried to do to make it kind of human readable, each node in the graph, and what you have is you have nodes and edges. The edges are essentially the links. There will be attributes associated with them. So we've kind of categorized them into either a compute, storage, or a network node, depending on the function. And as you go all the way down to the bottom, you can see that whether your service is running on an Atom processor or a Xeon processor, or your service has been written in such a way that it can offload workload to a Xeon Phi, which is a co-processor, or a quick assist type switch, which is another chip on the board that you can offload encryption from the core, from the CPU, onto this chip, so you can run a lot of parallel tasks just to increase performance. So I'm afraid to press a button. Is there a laser? Is the top one a laser?
I'll point.
So, but the point is, your service is at the top. So we can categorize them into maybe an object store type service, which might be a storage type solution, like a Dropbox, for example. And you've got your video transcoding, your transmuxers, which are supplying the Netflix and the YouTubes. And the WordPress is your website, and you might have enterprise resource type software, which are running your IT departments. Each of those services will perform differently depending on the underlying infrastructure that's been assigned to it. In the middle of the virtual layer, the amount of cores you've assigned to it, the amount of RAM. So again, what we're seeing is the infrastructure providers are over allocating to be able to satisfy service level agreements. So with that landscape view, what we've gone and generated is the ability to run subgraphs. So if you take the green one there, the service subgraph, that allows you to pull out a service that you're interested in and see what attributes have been assigned. So the service is running within a VM and it's running on a physical compute host, and there's attributes assigned to it. So all we need to do is see how it's performing in that configuration with a view to seeing where we can improve. But if you're the infrastructure supplier, the data center, maybe you want to run the blue graph, which is the physical layer, that shows, you know, what are the physical components that are running in my infrastructure, in my data center, from a capacity planning point of view. So you can see what services are starting to come in and what capacity I need to potentially to plan for. And then you can do other variations. You can do like a customer subgraph, which might be sort of like a service chain. If you've got multiple services that are all talking to each other in a chain, we want to see what kind of attributes have been assigned to it as well. So the landscape allows you to pull this kind of graph, and it, as I said, it's an open source product that we're using Recap to then try and extend and add additional functionalities to. So this is kind of like a low level design of how it works. I'm really almost reluctant just to kind of go through it, but the point is, it's a plug-in architecture. We have taken into account how your cloud setup is done, so you can write a plugin that will then import the relevant node. So we originally was OpenStack. So for example, the Heat plugin will bring in what the services are. Nova is about your VMs. Neutron is your network. So, but the point is, it'll pull in all the relevant items. So if you came along and you said, well, you know, we use AWS or we use CloudStack, all you would need to do is just create your own plugins that would pull in that part of your infrastructure into it. And you know, even Docker, for example, you'd want to bring in your Docker containers and your Docker tasks and model them, that'll do it. And then lastly, one of the new things we did for Recap was, if you want to just run experiments, you don't have a physical infrastructure, provided you write your CSV file in a certain format, you can go and import a model so you can actually then play around and run experiments with, which is something we'll be doing as part of ReCal. So again, just a simple example of what a service stack will look like. You can take in any service that you're interested in modeling its performance, whether that is a VNF or some different types of service. It'll run probably in some sort of virtualized infrastructure, and there'll be a number of physical attributes that have been assigned, like cores, storage, maybe a bit of network. And to explain it nice and simple, that's the 1x view. But if you zoom right down, it's actually much more complicated than that. You know, you'll have some volume attached to it, you'll have virtual network resources, you'll have virtual switch, you'll have physical switch network resources assigned to it. And that's before you even get to the physical layer at all, where you've got your cache, your level 3 cache, which potentially has to throw cache hits, cache misses, your level 2. So the point is this, it becomes very, very detailed. And as you change each one of these nodes and change the configuration for that particular service, you're going to see massive performance swings. And that's the thing we're trying to resolve here. Can we predict how a service will perform under different types of loads? Again, I'm definitely not going to go through this slide, but the point is, for each of the nodes in that graph, this is all the metadata that you can actually capture to it, simply for, you know, for the core. So you're looking at about 20 to 30 different types of low-level attributes. It makes it very, very detailed. Okay, so now you know exactly how your service is deployed, what resources you've assigned to it, how does it perform. So this is where telemetry comes in. Now, Intel is a contributor to a lightweight telemetry system, which is called Snap. And again, it's open source, so it is up on GitHub. But depending on your own background, maybe you want to use telemetry frameworks like Barometer or CollectD, which is another one. They're just telemetry frameworks. And what a lot of them will do is they abstract the original source of the telemetry and allows you to process it in advance. So your metric source could be something like the temperature sensor that's built into the hardware. It could be Intel's performance counter, the PCM tool, that allows you to see how your CPU is performing. So you have your original metric source, and then you have your collector that's written on top of it. Now, if you skip the processor just for a second, and you just go straight to your publisher, your publisher is then going to put that in a file, or it's going to put it in a time series database and allow you to see how that service for that particular window is executing and pull the relevant telemetry for it. Now, for Snap, and I'm not necessarily plugging Snap, is you've got a command line interface, you've got a RESTful interface. So you can go in and trigger it, and then Tribe actually provides an opportunity if you want to cluster a lot of how you're collecting metrics. So, as I said, you've got your original source of your metrics here on your left, which is your collector. You've got your publisher over on the right, which is then putting it in different types of locations. The question you need to ask yourself is, do I need to publish absolutely everything? So if I have a probe that's pulling, you know, potentially a metric, 10 metrics every second, if you do the maths on that, as that starts to add up, that becomes quite a lot of data that you're storing that may only be relevant when that service was alive. And you may want to decide, well, do I want to filter it? And that's where the processor comes in. So you can go and write processor plugins that will allow you to filter the data in advance of it being published. So a simple one, you might just want to aggregate. Maybe you just want to start publishing averages. And this becomes very, very relevant when you're measuring service performance at the edge. Because at the edge, you're going to have network connectivity issues where it may only connect maybe once every now and again. Similarly, you're going to be paying for your network connection. So every time you send data, you're going to have to pay for that. Do you need to send everything? So that's where the processor comes in. So if you only want to be publishing averages or standard deviations or some sort of variation, that's where you can write a processor. And one of the processors we wrote was an anomaly detection approach. So what the processor does is it caches a 60-second period of data, and it goes in and analyzes it. And if it sees that the data is pretty much the same for the whole 60 seconds, it just publishes the average. And it'll put that into time series database. But let's say something interesting happened. There's a variation. You can see it there with the two circles in the graph. In that case, it just publishes the whole lot. Because you're some sort of analytics framework that you may have, may want to go in and see what exactly what it is. So in that case, yes. So what we're seeing is this reduction in your storage, because you're not now saving 10 metrics per second for 150 type probes. You may only be storing averages. And the other is your transmission savings. So if you're paying for your network access, you don't want to be focused on. And we're seeing roughly about 10x reductions in costs around those two areas. So wiring those two things back together. We have our service deployed on its infrastructure. We have all the different elements in there. We know exactly what configuration and what deployment it is. The next thing we want to do is we want to start adding in that telemetry for that time period where the service was alive. And now we can generate these contextualized type graphs, and we can start analyzing service performance. So depending on whether you're more interested in how the service is performed or whether how the infrastructure is performing, you can start looking at capacity planning type stuff. So you can start looking at balancing your nominal versus your sold, which are potential. And you can start going into some sort of overselling type models while still satisfying the SLA that's been demanded by the customers, because you have the data potentially to back it up. And for us, we're more interested in the service analysis. So we want to take services that have been deployed, see if we can characterize the performance, and see if we can optimize that initial placement. So, you know, will a service perform exactly the same if four virtual CPUs have been assigned to it as two virtual CPUs? Are you requesting a 10 gig access quality of service when maybe a five? And again, the savings there are for the actual application owner, because they don't need to pay for all this extra equipment. The infrastructure provider can make money because he can take that infrastructure and potentially sell it on to a different customer. So there's savings from both sides. Which now kind of brings us into the BT use case. So for BT, what they did was they brought in an area around their virtual CDN, so their caches, and how they're going to deploy that on their infrastructure around the UK. So no different to any problem telco in any country. They're set about their network, starts with their internet exchange and those centralized locations, and then branches out into the core sites, which would be essentially regional, the metro sites, which is kind of within the cities, and then the access nodes, which is the last point before your data goes into your house. And they have loads of redundancy built in. And their challenges kind of fall under, well, they want to place the cache. So how are they going to place this virtual cache out on the different locations? And these are essentially remote data centers. So they're micro data centers at the edge. So they're looking at the performance of the virtualized technologies, because you know, we'll be assigning virtual network, virtual NICs, virtual switches. So they want to see how all those perform. Orchestration is the placement. So when do they need to place caches in every single location? And they want to look at scaling. And of course, they're interested in monitoring as well. So they need to ensure performance of the system to keep the customers happy. So the areas we're kind of go after kind of fall into these type optimization approaches. But really, to sum it up, we're kind of very much interested in taking the service, which in this case is a VNF, it's a cache, it's a vCDN, and best mapping how it performs to best resources. So top of my head, I would say if it's going to be a cache, probably an SSD. Because it's going to be rewriting to disk quite fast, and it's going to be delivering content, so SRIOV, a direct connection to the PCI Express, would probably see massive improvements. But that's me sitting there hard encoding that into the deployment configuration. And while it might work for an experiment here, it's not going to work at scale. So if you think a service provider is going to get thousands of services coming in, they cannot have a team of minions that are sitting there analyzing the service, manually creating configuration files. So what they need to do is, we need to do this at scale, we need to do it automated, and these are kind of the approaches we're looking at. So the first one is, can we characterize the workload as it runs and best place it on resources assigned to it? The second one is, let's analyze the telemetry. So if you're measuring 150 type metrics, are 150 type metrics relevant to that particular service? Is it maybe only 10% of those metrics? And as I said, for a virtual cache type service, disk I/O, network I/O are probably going to be top of the list. So can we identify which metrics are more relevant for that particular workload? And the last one is about utility theory. So can we take a look at balancing basically the provider and the customer? So the provider wants to reduce his total cost of ownership and increase his gross profit. The customer wants to get service performance, and get availability, throughput, low latency, and pay the minimum amount. So there's a balance. And that's what the multi-attribute utility theory will do. It'll try and generate this balance of keeping the provider happy and the customer happy. So let me skip the slide and talk. So what we've been doing in the project is, we took our landscaper and we have modeled BT's infrastructure. The service is over there on the right and how it's going to get deployed. And what we need to do now is run it through the simulator, which is where DCU will step in. And what we'll do is we'll take telemetry and put it, and we'll see how that service performs with a view to generating what the optimal solution is. So just in the interest of time, we are just a year into the project. It's a 3-year project. And there are the success criteria we have to stand up to within the BT. So modeling its performance, learning its configuration automatically, and finding optimal placement decisions. So, sorry, slightly rushed the last couple of slides, just got the nod from the boss. So, I'll be hanging around. I'll grab a free sandwich later on. So if anybody wants to approach and just ask any questions, I'll be here for a while.
Thank you, Alec.